bienvenida a esta 14ª edición de la iniciativa conjunta de IESE Fundación Naturgy. Hoy me acompaña Rafael Villaseca. En teoría, mi papel es el institucional y el suyo sería el profesional, pero claro, él sabe de IESE mucho más que yo ya. Sabéis, Rafael ha sido presidente de los antiguos alumnos de IESE durante muchísimos años y, por tanto, casi que me va a liberar de la tarea de trabajar esta tarde. Bueno, me parece que hablar de la importancia del sector es ocioso. Todos estáis aquí porque sois muy conscientes de ello. Y lo que desde el IESE tengo que hacer es congratularme que hayamos podido traer a gente de tantísimo nivel en estas 14 ediciones. Y hoy me parece pues que casi que mejoramos lo pasado, porque tenemos a dos figuras de muchísima relevancia que Rafael nos presentará. A Carlos Pascual, que estará online desde México, vicepresidente senior de Energía Global y Asuntos Internacionales de Standards & Poor's, y Thomas Schlaak, aquí presente, que es el responsable mundial del sector de la energía, los servicios públicos y las energías renovables en Deloitte. Bueno, me parece que la visión de nuestros ponentes es lo más importante que vamos a hacer esta tarde y, por tanto, no os voy a entretener mucho. Solamente insistir en la satisfacción por parte del IESE de ser fieles a la misión nuestra de provocar lugares de encuentro y servir a la comunidad de nuestros antiguos alumnos, de nuestros amigos, para que en un lugar neutral donde se pueda hablar de todo, se puedan avanzar en diálogo constructivo soluciones que beneficien a las empresas y a la sociedad. Don Rafael, el floor is yours.
Muchas gracias, Francisco. Muy buenas tardes a todos, tanto a los que están hoy aquí presencialmente en esta aula como a los que se han conectado online con nosotros. Con un cambio de hora que ruego disculpen, pero que tiene que ver con que desafortunadamente nuestro ponente de hoy, Carlos Pascual, ha tenido una indisposición, una neumonía que no le ha permitido trasladarse y venir esta mañana, estar con nosotros aquí en Madrid como hubiera sido su deseo y eran sus planes iniciales. Quisiera agradecer de una manera muy singular a Carlos Pascual esta disposición, a pesar de todo ello, para poder hoy acompañarnos y online darnos sus opiniones sobre esos temas tan interesantes. Quisiera agradecerlo de una manera, como digo, singular, dada la situación concreta que explicaba. Y a todos, pues la amabilidad también, haber cambiado las horas para poder asistir y estar hoy con nosotros. Es conocida la idea de la Fundación, junto con el IESE, en estas jornadas. Empiezo por agradecer al IESE que nos haya acogido ya durante 14 sesiones y nos haya ayudado a formar, conformar y desarrollar estas reuniones que me atrevo a decir que tienen una razonable acogida, casi diría que un razonable éxito entre las personas que siguen el sector energético. En esas 14 jornadas hemos intentado que opiniones fundadas sirvan para que todos los interesados en el sector puedan, quien trabaja en el sector, trabajar, quien piensa, quien dirige, quien regula, tengan puntos de referencia para hacerlo con más datos, con más profundidad en opiniones, con más reflexión. En muchas ocasiones son muchas las personas del sector quienes nos quejamos de que en muchas ocasiones no se toman las decisiones con la profundidad de análisis y de consideración que son imprescindibles en un sector tan complicado como es el sector de la energía. Bien. Hemos puesto nuestro grano de arena en la Fundación mediante una serie de actuaciones, publicaciones, conferencias, libros, etcétera, pero una de las que más estamos satisfechos son estos encuentros del que hoy es el número 14. Y los hemos hecho focalizando cada tres meses en un tema concreto y trayendo a dos ponentes de gran nivel, como los que hoy nos acompañan. Y así pues hemos tenido ocasión de tener personas que nos hablaran de la energía en relación a un montón de cuestiones muy relevantes. Energía y geoestrategia, mercados, regulación, modelos energéticos, sistemas de generación, economía y finanzas, temas laborales, incluso política, como es bien conocido en recientes sesiones que tuvieron lugar también aquí. Hoy nuestro objetivo es poder tener una visión general que agrupe todo esto, teniendo en cuenta dos marcos, el marco americano, básicamente norteamericano, y el marco europeo. Para ello tenemos la oportunidad de contar con dos ponentes excepcionales que serán moderados por el profesor Máximo Mauret, a quien quiero ya en primer lugar agradecerle también su disposición para este acto. Y nuestros dos ponentes lo son de un nivel realmente excepcional. Lo decía ya Francisco, Carlos Pascual es vicepresidente de Energía Global y Asuntos Internacionales de Standard & Poor's, pero además de haber sido embajador de los Estados Unidos, ha estado íntimamente relacionado con los asuntos energéticos internacionales de los Estados Unidos y creó y dirigió la Oficina de Recursos Energéticos del Departamento de Estado. Sin duda una personalidad que conoce perfectamente cuál es la situación en los Estados Unidos y en el mundo de este complejo mundo nuestro de la energía. Y Thomas Schlaak, a quien también agradezco de una manera muy singular su amabilidad de acompañarnos hoy, es el responsable mundial del sector de la energía de Deloitte. Tiene más de 25 años de experiencia en este sector y ha estado relacionado con muy importantes empresas de servicios energéticos europeos y operadores, transmisores de electricidad y gas y también de empresas internacionales, siempre además considerando el punto de vista de los clientes. Sin duda alguna conoce de una manera extraordinaria el panorama europeo y ha tenido la oportunidad de tener una visión muy amplia de lo que significa este mercado en la actual, llamémosle transición, crisis, como ustedes quieran, de la energía. A todos ellos les quiero agradecer muy singularmente su disposición a estar hoy y a estar esta tarde con nosotros, y no quisiera ya alargar más esta presentación, insistiendo en agradecer a todos la amabilidad que han tenido al conectarse y venir singularmente a nosotros y comprometernos a intentar seguir cada trimestre teniendo una reunión como la que hoy nos acoge aquí en las aulas del IESE. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much for the kind invitation, Professor Iniesta, Mr. Villaseca. It's always a pleasure to be in Madrid. Unfortunately, I don't come here every month, every year even, but I regularly visit my colleagues from Deloitte here in this fantastic city. And it's really an honor to be invited to this prestigious conference, and thanks for allowing me to share some comments on the energy transition. As I like to speak about to you about the status of the energy transition globally, but most importantly on the status here in Europe. The energy transition is a heated debate, as we all know, especially these days with the UK pulling back on their commitments, delaying deadlines. Germany, my country where I live, a heated debate on whether we are overpacing the decarbonization of our industry. At the same time, if we look into the news, the temperature recordings from September this year is off the charts, right? It's really the highest recorded temperatures ever. And that could really make you think, and really you get depressive. So this is not what I want to do today, to make you depressive. I still like to take a look at the energy transition with a realistic, if not positive, attitude, and reflect on how far have we come, and what we need to do to use the momentum to get forward even more consequently. There's a lot of problems, yes, but there's also a lot of solutions out there. So for this, I would like to give you an overview in just 20, 25 minutes. I will start by reminding us on the global challenge. I will then turn to the European energy markets, especially the power market, but then also as a second step, the gas market. And here I will focus my remarks, particularly on hydrogen. And I also have a few remarks on European industrial competitiveness. So quite of an agenda, a big agenda, so let me take you through the slides that I will use in order to back up my arguments. And as you would expect from a consultant, I can't do this without slides, right? So let us start with sort of the global perspective. And as we all know, the energy transition is a gigantic task. Yeah? We need to design and we need to build a largely new energy infrastructure for the world. And as you can see, and I'm sure you know these numbers from the IEA, the amounts that need to be invested are massive. But also you see from the data that already today we invest more in clean tech than we invest in great tech. Yeah. Still, if you look at the multiples, we need to do even more. We need to accelerate the investments into clean tech going forward if we want to continue aim for a net zero scenario. Now these investments actually do show impact on our emissions. As you can see from the left-hand graph, the growth of emissions output is slowing down. Yeah? It's still going up, but it's slowing down. And if you look at Europe and the US, you actually see that these two regions globally are the front runners in actually reducing relatively the emissions. And I always, when I look at this chart, find it fascinating to look at the US, how the coal to gas switch actually has reduced their carbon footprint dramatically over the last 10 to 15 years. Now it's also clear to see that China and India pose a problem as they are not peaking yet, and there's still some time to come until they peak. And when we turn to the right-hand side of the graph, we do see that obviously the plans that are currently out there, and this is data from the IPCC, the National Determined Contribution Plans, they get us to a climate target of around 2.4, 2.5 increase of the global average temperature, clearly above the 2 degree target from the Paris Accord. And when we say 2.5 degrees above average temperature, this is obviously a figure on average around the globe. We all know there's 70% of oceans, there's 30% of land mass. This means that the temperature increase in this scenario over land mass is more like 4 to 8 degrees, right? Which is obviously substantial. Hence, we will actually see, in my opinion, more climate impact protection to become more important and become more of a central part of the climate policy going forward. But that is a topic for a whole different keynote that we can then maybe do at a different time. When we then turn to actually who is doing this, right? Are we actually alone here in Europe? Are we the only ones that actually are on the, you know, on the way to decarbonize our economies? And we do look across and analyze what are the plans that the different countries have set out. We actually do see that we're not alone. All major regions in the world have set out binding targets, the US, China, Europe. More of them have announced targets. Some of them have not yet announced a target. Obviously still the long-term target of China and India, especially as they want to get to net zero only in the 60s and 70s, is a problem. Yes, Southeast Asia needs to actually come forward with a binding agreement, as Africa still needs to do. But I would say the argument that Europe is doing is the only region in the world that is actually thinking about this, that is investing in this, that is actually changing, is not correct. Still, the big question is to what extent actually these legally binding agreements actually can be enforced if the going gets tough. This is a question for geopolitics, and maybe we hear about this in a minute. And it's clearly a question and a call for action for European diplomacy that, you know, binding agreements is one thing, really having a mechanism to ensure that they are actually fulfilled is another one. So maybe that for context in terms of where we are globally, let's turn to the European energy markets. And let me start out with the power market. We at Deloitte, we regularly do study the European power market. We call this the Future of Power study. We recently redone our analysis of the European power market this year. And we do simulate with our fundamental models the power market, but not only the power market, but also the demand markets, transport, the industrial use, the heat use, the power use. We do this in scenarios, extreme scenarios, but still plausible scenarios. So all of these four scenarios that I briefly talk about sort of in my point of view are thinkable and really sort of define the spectrum of what could happen in my point of view. So the scenarios are determined by two political factors. One, first, global geopolitics, and second, the coherence of the European energy policy, energy market, and decarbonization policy. So in that context, we could imagine a world that continues to deglobalize with continued geopolitical tensions, with Europe isolating. However, we could also see a world and imagine a world that rediscovers and reconfirms the value of multilateralism, the value of trade, the value of technology innovation sharing. We also can imagine a European Union where the outside pressure actually strengthens the Union and make the Green Deal a reality with solidarity and actually burden sharing of the decarbonization. Still, we can also imagine a European Union where different economic prospects of member states drive more to individualistic approaches to deal with the decarbonization and actually have more of a scattered approach. As you can see from the graph, we call these scenarios then sort of with different names. The green independence one is a geopolitically tense world where the European Union stands together. Open clean tech is the world where we're still open for trade, open for innovation. Whereas growth before climate is more a pessimistic scenario where the European Union is not able to pull off its strength and we're putting growth before maybe climate actions in some of the European countries. Now, what all these scenarios have in common is a few things. One, they all assume a massive amount of electrification, as you can see from the numbers. And we all in all scenarios reduce the CO2 footprint quite a bit. Now, in the two left-hand scenarios, we actually get to net zeros, and the others, we still reduce it by 70 or almost 80%. So what they also have in common is whether they're optimistic like the open clean tech scenario or more pessimistic like the growth before climate scenario. In all of the scenarios, electricity demand is rising significantly, CO2 is decreasing strongly. In all of the scenarios, power generation is dominated by wind and solar. And in all of the scenarios, we need gas-based generation capacity to balance the system. And in the net zero scenarios, we also need negative emission technology in order actually to get there. Right? This will require quite some investment. The investments in each scenario are enormous. To our calculations, we talk about up to 3 trillion euros accumulated investment until 2050. When you look to the right-hand side of the slide and we look at the power prices that we anticipate, and these are wholesale prices without grid cost in such a world, we get to actually an average of power prices that are not that different than what we see today. Now, you also see, as we all know, if we get into a energy system that is more and more dominated by renewables, we see higher volatility. Actually, we have excluded the price spikes positively and negatively on this chart. You know, you see the 5% to 95% price interval here. But clearly, this is something that will characterize power markets going forward, and that's why also we see more longer-term instruments like PPAs, contract for differences, etc., being discussed. It is important, in my point of view, to mention that we also need to see those prices, right? Only if we see these kind of price levels, we can pull off the investments that is needed to actually to rebuild the system, right? Which is a important message, I think, also to regulators, because sometimes people say, you know, the sun is for free, the wind is for free. Actually, energy prices can come down because of this, these technologies. That is not necessarily my view, because all of these projects need to be economic in order for them to be bankable, in order for them to be able to be funded. In order to realize these investments, we also need, obviously, bigger scale supply chains in the right size, be it on the technology side, in terms of building the equipment, and also on the project development side, actually building the wind parks, the solar parks, etc. As you can see on the left-hand side, the European Union has put out quite some targets, how to rebuild some of the production capacity in Europe for solar or batteries. This may look like high multiples, but then again, I think we've proven in Europe before that we're able to do this, that we're able to build industrial capacities over the course of a decade. And especially when we look to the right-hand side of the graph, what would be needed in order to actually, as a build-out ratio, you see here that, for example, the deployment of PV solar in Europe would need a multiple of by 7 over the next decades. Now, per decade, that is, and 7 is a big number. Now, if we think from decade to decade, this is more or less a doubling, right? So, which then again sounds somewhat more realistic, right? So, a big task to also build the supply chains, obviously, in order to get there. Then, let me turn to the gas market and to the European gas markets. And I guess that's no secret that, you know, given the decarbonization of European industry and given the policies that the members, most of the members firms, member states have issued, we will see a declining demand of natural gas in the European Union. At the same time, we also see rising demand for biomethane and hydrogen in the European Union. Right, so that the overall gas market, fossil plus biomethane plus hydrogen, from energy content may actually not that different than what we see today. But clearly, you know, with regards to power generation and you know, in some countries at least, with regards to residential heat, we see changes going forward. When we look to the right-hand side, and this is based on a recent Deloitte study where we've analyzed the global hydrogen market, it's also apparent that the demand will not be produced in Europe alone. This is unrealistic, even in a, you know, isolistic scenario like the green independence scenario. We will be dependent on imports of hydrogen going forward. In our view, this is almost half of it, maybe 40%, with a accelerating share towards the 40s and the 50s. And this hydrogen will come largely from the global south that we're importing into Europe, from North Africa, from Southern Africa, from also other places. In the global south. Now also, this transition is quite costly. and requires huge investments, as you would imagine. What you can see here on the left-hand side of the graph is part of that Deloitte study that I was mentioning, where we've calculated what would be the needed investment if we would build a hydrogen economy, a global hydrogen economy that has the size which is needed to decarbonize global industry. For Europe, this is alone 1.1 trillion accumulated cumulative investments until 2050. So also a big, staggering number. When you look to the right, though, in our point of view, you see that these investments also should lead to cost and therefore also price levels that are substantially, significantly below what we see today in the hydrogen market. We assume that around 90% of European demand can be met in the 40s, you know, late 40s, that 90% of European demand can be met by supplies that have cost of less than €1.90 per kilogram in today's prices, so not considering inflation. This assumes, obviously, that we allow imports into Europe. Yeah, this assumes that we're also finding a solution to the financing problem that the Global South have, because today many of these projects are disadvantaged because of the high cost of capital that these projects face. Yeah, so this is obviously assumed that we find a solution in the next 10 to 20 years for these kind of problems. If we take a little bit of a closer look to Europe and more recent look, you see here our analysis of what are actually announced projects in the European Union. We at Deloitte track all of the hydrogen projects that are out there. We do this with a almost automated process where we scan all announcements and sort of through natural language processing then take the analysis in terms of what kind of project is this, et cetera. So we have a daily count on what is announced there. When we look at the data, and this is data from this summer, so not from yesterday, but from this summer, we see that we're short of meeting the European target of 10 million tons per year. There's at least 1 million ton missing, because this would assume that all the announced projects are actually being built, which is, as we know, maybe not always realistic. So we need more. We need more production projects here in Europe, and that's why that production can be drawn to other places is a real risk, as you know, I'm sure, especially to the US with the Inflation Reduction Act putting forward very attractive incentives, and I think we hear about that in a few minutes. I think it's fair to say that even though the IRA sets out very attractive incentives, it's also clear that the details are not worked out yet in the IRA. They're currently being worked out. So let's see how the US administration is really then making sort of getting to the details so that projects actually become also more real over there. However, what is important that the European instruments that are out there, the European Hydrogen Bank and the H2 Global Program that at least some member states have issued, that they are successful. As you know, currently the European Hydrogen Bank auctions have been initiated. Bidders are putting in their bids in order to apply for funding and get or start to do this now. I think a deadline is in February to then get the the funding by the European Union, and with the H2 Global, which is the funding mechanism by the German government, the Dutch government, and maybe soon some other governments will join. The bidding processes has started as well, with bids due in November, December this year. So we're importing countries like Oman, India, etc., put forward their hydrogen projects concretely in order to then sign import contracts with the H2 Global Foundation to then start delivering the hydrogen as of, you know, 27, 28, 29 into Europe. So very important that we also in Europe have instruments that attract actually investment. But also there, the message is stuff is happening, right? It's not that there's a problem, but there's also solutions to it. And if we take it on, we actually do advance. And this demand is really materializing more and more as we speak. Here you see two examples where I'm personally involved. On the left-hand side, you see an oil refinery converting to biogene energy. On the right-hand side, a steel producer investing into green steel, transforming the classical route to a electric arc furnace technology, where they also will use down the road hydrogen. Both projects have in common that they will require massive amounts of hydrogen going forward. They also have in common that the supply chain behind these projects alone are also enormous. If we think about the refinery, they would need up to 1.5 million tons of biomass each year. So part of that will be covered by biomass from forestry, straw, etc., which in that case alone would mean 365 days a year, so every day basically, 3 to 4 trains of biomass in order to convert part of one oil refinery. So massive amounts in order then to produce hydrogen through that route and also use the CO2 or the carbon then to maybe build other fuels. What is also in common of these two projects is that they require quite amounts of public funding to get to final investment decisions. This will be substantial. In this case, I think the German government will have to pay for this. So don't worry, not the Spanish one. It's also to be realistic a reality that these first projects need that funding now in order to then get to a final investment decision in, let's say, 24, 25, to then actually start producing more towards the end of this decade. So all these things require time. They're not built overnight. But the industry, in my point of view, is also moving, you know, in some parts of Europe, if not, you know, all parts of Europe. So let me turn to the topic around industrial competitiveness, competitiveness of the European industry at large when it comes to energy. And as you see here on the left-hand side of the chart, the European energy price crisis has been a shock, has been severe, but it's also fading out, and we get to somewhat more normal levels. And let's hope it's not coming back this winter, by the way. However, I think it's also clear, and I hope you would agree, that you will face and deal with a persistent energy price differential towards the US in the years to come on the natural gas side, and therefore also to some extent on the electricity side. So is that then leading to a deindustrialization in Europe, this price differential, which is, you know, a hot debate, at least in my country? And I would say the answer is not that easy. You know, for some sectors, maybe yes, but not for others. So when we look at the data, and you see here on the right-hand side, what is the share in the cost structure of energy as a utility, not as a feedstock, you get to different percentages, right? And if, for example, if I look to the automotive industry, which is a very important industry in Germany, but also in Europe overall, moving production from Europe to the US cannot be argued by energy costs. There are different reasons for this. There's also in the IRA incentives to do this around the battery strategy. But there are other industries where this is a big argument, fertilizers, et cetera. And clearly for the industries like chemicals, where energy is a big feedstock, it's a huge issue that regions like the US or the Middle East have access to just lower cost feedstock, which will lead to change in industrial competitiveness and hence also reallocation of along the value chain. And by the way, the production of renewables and then maybe low carbon hydrogen may also lead to this shift in value, because also the Global South obviously has the option to then go further in the value chain and produce, you know, not only the hydrogen but also the synthetic fuel and also the chemicals, etc., themselves, right? So clearly something that we here in Europe need to manage, that we are keeping our industrial base intact, at least to the extent that sort of makes sense. So let me close by what does it all mean now, right? So what is my takeaway? And I believe basically three things: straightforwardness, patience, and funding. So first, we need to become, in my point of view, more clear and turn to execution than rather perfecting our climate targets and plans. So, you know, which brings me to the second point. We need patience. The task is enormous and it requires time, right? Today's plans, especially in Europe, are already very, very ambitious, right? And to speed up these plans even further, you know, as you know, the temperature is rising and we feel time is running out, I feel is not the right thing. So a further acceleration actually may slow us down. Acceleration in plans may actually slow us down, because we will lose the social license actually to go through this transition, right? What is important, that we keep the plans and the execution open to all available technologies, that we're not sort of writing the plans knowing what will be the state of technology in 10 years from now. And this is true for the power sector, but especially for the decarbonization of industry. And finally, and this may be the biggest challenge, funding of the transformation. You've seen the numbers, they are staggering, right? The funding environment is not becoming easier with rising interest rates. When we look at the cash flow of the industry, of the energy industry, they're clearly not big enough to fund this alone, especially when you want to continue paying dividends to your shareholders. It's hard to see how this would work. Also, debt financing is not enough, because obviously the debt leverage is utilized quite a bit. New equity is needed. And I would say most probably without capping the investment risk by public lenders and public institutions, the risk return profiles are not attractive enough to mobilize capital quickly enough in order to sort of keep the momentum and increase it even further. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Thomas. I'm going to interject very quickly as we switch towards Carlos. I just want to remind everybody, and quiero recordar a todo el mundo, que tenemos no uno, no dos, pero tres protagonistas del día. El tercer no soy yo, sois vosotros, ¿no? Porque la audiencia tendrá la posibilidad de hacer preguntas a Thomas y a Carlos, también los que están conectados online, ¿no? Tengo aquí mi tableta. pues me entran todas las preguntas y también habrá la posibilidad de hacer preguntas aquí en presencia. Pues podemos tener la posibilidad no solo de escuchar, ¿no?, de estas presentaciones muy interesantes, pero también de entrar en discusión con Tomás y con Carlos más o menos en una media horita. Ahora pasamos la palabra a Carlos. Carlos Pascual, ya ha sido introducido, no quiero robarle más tiempo. Como ha recordado Rafael, desgraciadamente no ha podido estar con nosotros aquí por un tema de salud, pero nos alegramos muchísimo de que Carlos se sienta mejor, así que siga pudiendo conectarnos con nosotros. Y lo vemos aquí en el lado, tenemos su presentación. Carlos, te paso la palabra. 20-25 minutos, un poco como Tomás, y después entramos en la fase de discusión. Muchas gracias. A ver, que no te escuchamos, pero seguro que lo vamos a arreglar.
Ok, ¿me pueden escuchar?
Ahora sí, súper bien. Muchas gracias. Adelante.
Perfecto. Muchísimas gracias. Qué placer poder, por lo menos virtualmente, estar con ustedes. Hace como 10 días me dio una neumonía y me tuve que cancelar todos los viajes. Estoy mejor, espero que pueda hablar bien, pero lastimamente no estoy con ustedes ahí ahora en Madrid. Thomas, thank you for your presentation. Very excellent. Really laid out the case very well on many global issues and issues related to Europe. Yo quiero tratar sobre dos tipos de temas. Primero es la geopolítica que estamos viendo alrededor de la transición energética y cómo se conectan con los escenarios que tenemos para el futuro. Y entonces quiero entrar a unos temas específicos que tocan en temas del mercado y qué estamos viendo, cómo estamos viendo esta conexión entre geopolítica y los mercados el día de hoy. Es una presentación un poco dura. Lo que tenemos enfrente de nosotros es un desafío que nunca se ha hecho en el mundo. Una transición tecnológica, comercial y política también en un periodo de tiempo que va a ser muy, muy corto. 27 años que estamos diciendo de ahora para el año 2050 para llegar a neto cero de emisiones. Y no lo podemos hacer si no confrontamos en una manera muy clara los desafíos que tenemos enfrente de nosotros y lo difícil que va a ser. Pero el primer punto donde quería empezar es que esto no es solamente un tema de geopolítica. Lo que hemos visto es que el mundo que nos dio certidumbre sobre un periodo de 7 décadas, que fue la fuente de crecimiento económico, se nos ha explotado enfrente de nosotros. Cuando preparé esto, lo puse en el contexto de la guerra en Ucrania. Lo podemos añadir todavía más con lo que ha pasado el último fin de semana en Israel y en Gaza. Si miramos la parte de seguridad, lo que hemos visto con la guerra en Ucrania es que las instituciones que tenemos el día de hoy no lo han podido prevenir, no lo pueden parar. Si miramos la situación en Israel, un problema muy profundo sobre cómo apoyar el fin del terrorismo. Del otro lado, cuánto tiempo demora para poder encontrar una solución de los palestinos. No tenemos las instituciones el día de hoy para resolver esos problemas. Si vemos a la parte comercial, la pandemia nos hizo empezar a cuestionar totalmente las reglas que existían anteriormente sobre la globalización. Recuérdense cuando se hizo un asunto de seguridad nacional, si tenías un cubreboca que se podía producir en tu país, así, por cierto, aconteció en Estados Unidos. Y empezó este tema de nearshoring de los supply chains, traerlo todavía más cerca. Y las reglas de comercio que tenemos en el OMC se empezaron a cuestionar. Y con la transición energética, recuérdense, en el COP26, en Glasgow, salimos de esa reunión lanzados para la neta cero de emisiones. Aconteció la guerra en Ucrania. ¿Y qué empezamos a ver? Los choques geopolíticos pueden afectar cómo se mueven los recursos y la capacidad de abastecer los mercados que tenemos el día de hoy. Y lo que empecemos a entender es que no solamente algo geopolítico, pero puede ser comercial, tecnológico y y de la parte de policy, no de político, de politics, pero de policy también. Y todo esto en conjunto, en donde nos ha dejado es que no solamente estamos tratando de manejar una transición energética, la orden global que hemos tenido se ha explotado también, está en cuestión y estamos tratando de crear algo nuevo, más amplio, para darnos más confianza. Yo diría que lo que estamos viendo ahora en la política alrededor de nosotros está haciendo esto más complicado. Si vemos la guerra entre Rusia y Ucrania, la invasión de Ucrania, el día de hoy yo no veo ninguna perspectiva por un acuerdo diplomático. De la parte de Rusia, una invasión decidida solamente por una persona, Vladimir Putin, con la perspectiva que él dijo que él iba a denazificar a Ucrania, que iba a proteger los derechos de los ciudadanos rusos dentro de Ucrania. Y hemos visto que eso es totalmente falso. Y lo que hemos visto también es que Rusia anexó dos provincias al sur, dos provincias al este de Ucrania, declaró que eran parte de Rusia. Y para el presidente Putin, echarse para atrás ahora a este punto en donde él no puede proteger una parte que él ha dicho que es parte de Rusia, en donde la invasión que él hizo ha resultado en 100.000 personas que se han vuelto en el proceso, y que no pueda mostrar una ganancia clara de esta invasión, para él sería no solamente un derrumbe político, pero una amenaza a su vida también. Para Ucrania, está en una situación en donde ve una perspectiva que puede empezar a ganar territorio. Ha tenido apoyo de Europa, de Estados Unidos. Está en una situación con Estados Unidos ahora complicada, con lo que han visto que ha pasado con el Congreso de Estados Unidos. Pero si miras a las encuestas en Ucrania el día de hoy, más del 90% de la población dice que no quiere dar ninguna concesión de territorio para Rusia. Y para el presidente de Ucrania, si da cualquier concesión el día de hoy, no sería presidente de Ucrania. Entonces, la perspectiva de lo que vamos a ver en Rusia y entre Rusia y Ucrania es una guerra que va a seguir, con un fin que no sabemos todavía a este punto cómo se va a acabar. Lo que hemos visto este fin de semana en Israel y Gaza complica mucho más la situación en el Medio Oriente. ¿Y por qué aconteció ahora? Una perspectiva que por lo menos yo tengo es que una sorpresa a mucha gente que Arabia Saudita e Israel estaban muy cerca de llegar a un acuerdo para la extensión de los acuerdos de Abraham. Y con eso, Arabia Saudita estaba supuesto a recibir una garantía de seguridad de parte de los Estados Unidos y hubiera creado un sistema, un orden político y de seguridad totalmente distinto para el Medio Oriente y contra Irán. Protección contra Irán. Y creo que en parte lo que hemos visto es que Irán analizó esta situación y llegó a una conclusión. Si no hay un acto a este punto para derrumbar esta situación, este cambio va a ser una realidad. Del punto de vista de los palestinos, lo que estaban viendo es ninguno de los otros países que tuvieron un acuerdo con Israel tomó medidas para la protección de los palestinos. ¿Y por qué pensar que iba a ser real ahora con Arabia Saudita? Y lo que hemos visto ahora es, en el Medio Oriente, un cambio que nos deja en una situación muy frágil. Arabia Saudita, que quería tener el poder y el liderazgo de la región con el apoyo de Estados Unidos, ahora está en una situación de incertidumbre. ¿Quiere Arabia Saudita mantener una conexión con Estados Unidos, con Rusia y con China y manejarlas todas? La situación en Israel muy débil, la situación con Irán frágil, ninguna perspectiva para un acuerdo de controlar el programa nuclear y nos deja en una situación de más incertidumbre de lo que teníamos anteriormente. La semana pasada yo te hubiera dicho que la incertidumbre principal que tenemos, el riesgo principal que tenemos en el globalmente de relaciones exteriores es entre Estados Unidos y China. Y lo que hemos visto es un ciclo de deterioración de estas relaciones alrededor del comercio y alrededor de Taiwán. Y lo que hemos visto es una tentativa con reuniones que han tenido para poner un piso en esa deterioración, pero no hemos llegado ahí. Y particularmente si tomamos el ejemplo de semiconductores. Esto para China fue una declaración de guerra cuando Estados Unidos prohibió el acceso a China de semiconductores de precisos de alto nivel. ¿Y por qué? Porque afecta el acceso a supercomputing, a la inteligencia artificial, al machine learning y el futuro económico de China. Y si vamos a los países en desarrollo, lo que vemos, particularmente después de este fin de semana, es una declaración de hipocresía hacia Estados Unidos, hacia Europa. Y lo que están diciendo es, estamos apoyando a Ucrania, pero ¿dónde vino el apoyo y la atención a los palestinos sobre un periodo de 40 años? Y realmente tienen una atención para prestarle atención a los países de desarrollo. Y finalmente tengo que tocar en Estados Unidos. El día de hoy, yo diría que la incertidumbre, el riesgo número uno geopolítico globalmente es qué va a pasar en Estados Unidos con estas elecciones. Porque lo que estamos viendo es que hay una polarización sobre cada tema que uno puede imaginar. Sobre las armas, sobre raza, sobre mujeres, los derechos de mujeres, la migración, el manejo de la deuda. Y cómo Estados Unidos puede ser una fuerza para unificar el resto del mundo si tenemos este nivel de tensión dentro del país. La razón que toco en todos estos temas es que lo tenemos que conectar con los escenarios para el futuro a llegar a neta cero de emisiones. Igual que Deloitte, igual que presentó Tomás, nosotros trabajamos con escenarios. No quiere decir que estos, como creemos que debe de ser el mundo, son escenarios para poder entender mejor el mundo. Esta de inflexiones aquí es más o menos consistente con la del panel de intergubernamental de cambio climático, que nos deja para el final del siglo un aumento de temperatura de 2.4 grados. Y podemos ver para 2050 una brecha enorme para neta cero de emisiones. Esta que llamamos Green Rules, imagínate tomar una legislación como en Estados Unidos del Inflation Reduction Act y extenderla algo similar que sea propio para el resto del mundo. Y finalmente tenemos dos casos de neta cero de emisiones. Pero para llegar aquí, teníamos que empezar al final y matemáticamente ir para atrás. No había manera que podíamos empezar aquí y llegar acá. Y la Agencia Internacional de Energía tuvo que hacer lo mismo. Una de las cosas que la gente nos reconoce de la Agencia Internacional de Energía es que nos dice que el día de hoy no tenemos tecnologías que son competitivas, comercialmente competitivas, para el 50% de las emisiones que tenemos que bajar el día de hoy. ¿Qué nos dice? Para llegar aquí, tenemos que ser perfectos. Y el mundo que tenemos el día de hoy no es perfecto. Está lleno de desafíos que son geopolíticos y técnicos también. Y requiere que tengamos un cambio total entre energía y el uso de combustibles fósiles. Lo que pueden ver aquí en la parte izquierda, empezando en el año 1990 y nos lleva hasta el año 2022, es que por todo ese periodo, 32 años, el mundo dependió en combustibles fósiles por 80% de la energía. 80%. Que nos quiere decir que durante todo ese periodo cambiamos un 2% nada más. Y sabemos que aumentamos muchísimo la energía renovable, pero fue básicamente para abastecer el aumento de demanda. Ahora, en 27 años, en contraste con 32, moviendo 2%, si vamos a llegar a neta cero de emisiones, estos son los dos escenarios. Aquí, igual con el escenario de nosotros, con lo que dijo Tomás, depende de captura de carbono o bonos de dióxido de carbono. Llegamos a 20 a 30% de la energía de combustibles fósiles. Pero mira el cambio que sería necesario. Y esto va a ser un desafío que es comercial, es técnico, es político, es social. Todos tenemos que cambiar aspectos de nuestra vida. Lo que sí sabemos, exactamente lo que dijo Tomás también, para Europa, para el resto del mundo, lo que tenemos que hacer es aumentar muchísimo el uso de energía eléctrica, y es lo que vemos aquí en todos los escenarios que tenemos, el aumento de energía eléctrica. Pero tenemos que prestarle atención a las cadenas de valor. Y aquí lo que podemos ver en verde es el control de China y lo que le pertenece a China para el litio, no sé decirlo en español, hydroxide, y los que controlan el proceso de litio globalmente, principalmente de China. Igualmente de la manufactura y el reciclaje de baterías. Y el cobalto, 80% en la República Democrática de Congo. La WEF, la World Economic Forum, nos ha estimado que la demanda de litio va a subir de 540 mil toneladas a 3 millones de toneladas para el año 2030. Para cobre, la demanda que hemos estimado en S&P creciendo de 25 millones de toneladas a 50 para el año 2035. Pero con esta realidad, toma en promedio globalmente 16 años para abrir una nueva mina. Entonces, ¿cómo lo vamos a hacer? Tenemos que hacer cambios tecnológicos, de química, y aquí todavía no tenemos las soluciones para cómo avanzarlo. Que no quiere decir que no deberíamos hacer todo para avanzar, pero tenemos que confrontar la realidad en donde estamos el día de hoy. Ahora vamos a llevar esto para distintos mercados. Y quiero empezar con Europa, y Tomás ha hablado mucho de Europa, pero Europa es la parte del mundo que ha confrontado un aspecto de transición que le va a venir al resto del mundo y tenemos que aprender. ¿Y qué pasó en Europa? De un día al otro, Rusia quitó 150 mil metros cúbicos de gas natural que estaba anteriormente exportando a Europa. Y la razón que lo estaba haciendo es esto aquí, una protesta en Eslovaquia, para fomentar protestas contra los gobiernos y tener un movimiento que pueda hacer a Europa repensar su apoyo para Ucrania. Eso no ha acontecido. Pero ¿cuáles son los desafíos? El plan de Europa para sustituir estos 155 mil millones de metros cúbicos era el uso de 50 más de gas natural líquido, 50 de hidrógeno renovable, como nos ha dicho Tomás, como él lo analizó, esto no va a acontecer para el año 2030. 18 de biometano no va a acontecer para ese periodo, que quiere decir que se va a tener que usar más gas natural o más carbón, mudando para el futuro. Que nos empiece a indicar esto. Para el proceso de transición a gas natural es una herramienta fundamental para facilitar este proceso, pero si lo ponemos en un contexto global, aquí mostramos por qué es todavía más importante. Lo que tienen aquí es el consumo de energía primaria en todo el mundo, y pueden imaginar qué es esto, los países del OCDE de Asia. Y aquí están las emisiones. Y nos empieza a decir esto. Si no resolvemos el problema de Asia para la demanda, para las emisiones, fallamos totalmente globalmente con la transición energética. Y si quitamos gas natural para facilitar el movimiento de carbón a un combustible que tenga menos dióxido de carbono, podemos complicar el tema y el desafío todavía más moviendo para el futuro. Otra cosa que sabemos es cuando no podemos abastecer el mercado, los precios aumentan. Aquí pueden ver petróleo. Aquí saben exactamente lo que aconteció. Empieza la guerra en Ucrania. El aumento de los precios de petróleo. Siguen alto, bajan un poco. Pero aquí viene otra pregunta que tenemos que estar preguntando. Para Arabia Saudita, para los cambios que ellos quieren en el futuro en su país, quieren un precio de $90 por barril. No lo han mantenido, pero cerca de por ahí lo tuvieron por las últimas semanas. Ahora, con lo que ha pasado en el Medio Oriente, con Israel y Gaza, con el colapso de los acuerdos que Arabia Saudita pensaba que iba a hacer, la perspectiva es que ellos van a tener que gastar todavía más. Y el interés que tengan para el costo del petróleo, para el precio del petróleo, probablemente va a subir. Esa es otra vulnerabilidad que tenemos que entender. Cuando hay una brecha entre la demanda, que es difícil bajar, y la oferta, los precios aumentan. Cuando los precios aumentan, el proceso de transición se hace más difícil. Perdón, dame un segundo. Lo que estamos viendo también con el petróleo es que no estamos reemplazando el promedio de reservas sobre los 5 años anteriores. Aquí ven todos los países principales, internacionales, privados para producción de petróleo. Aquí tienes la inversión orgánica y no llegan al promedio. Si agregas inversión inorgánica, pueden llegar ahí para algunas compañías. Pero en promedio, cuando mira esta línea de todos los IOCs, no estamos reemplazando el petróleo que todavía está consumiéndose globalmente. En parte, lo que estamos viendo en términos de CapEx es que las compañías principales están aumentando significativamente sus inversiones y sus gastos en tecnología de baja carbón. Pero esto todavía, dependiendo de la compañía, llegando solamente a 20 a 25% de CapEx. Pero la implicación es que la producción de las compañías privadas va a caer. Y para el año 2050, lo que vamos a ver es 70% del petróleo que vamos a tener en el mundo a ese punto va a venir de productores nacionales y principalmente del Medio Oriente. Ese es otro aspecto geopolítico de la transición energética que no se ha entendido bien. Ahora, ¿cómo salir de estos desafíos? Y el día de hoy se están haciendo apuestas en 2 tecnologías principales: la captura de carbono y de hidrógeno, y vamos a tocar cada uno y ponerlo en el contexto de Estados Unidos y el Inflation Reduction Act. El Inflation Reduction Act da una certidumbre que por 10 años, en el código de tasas para impuestos en Estados Unidos, se va a poder tener un crédito por las inversiones que se hacen. Y para la captura de carbono, dependiendo del tipo, el crédito puede ser entre $60 y $180 por tonelada. Significativo. Y la intención es para impulsar la experimentación y el uso de la tecnología para bajar los costos para que esto se pueda sostener en una manera que pueda ser comercialmente viable. Entonces, ¿cuál es la implicación para otros países? Muchos países están invirtiendo en Estados Unidos para tomar ventaja de los subsidios. Lo que tenemos que entonces empezar a apreciar es si van a empezar a aprender las lecciones de compañías europeas, por ejemplo, que están haciendo estas inversiones, ¿cómo pueden traer esas lecciones y la caída en los costos para Europa para aplicarlo ahí? En el mismo espíritu, hay un subsidio muy significativo en hidrógeno. Y ese subsidio se aplica en la energía renovable y también en hidrógeno directamente. Y cuando se combinan directamente, lo que podemos ver es una perspectiva que para el año 2027, el costo de hidrógeno verde puede estar entre 50 centavos a casi $2, a un precio bastante bajo. El hidrógeno azul a más o menos a los mismos precios, y que el hidrógeno verde en algunas circunstancias puede ser más barato que el hidrógeno gris producido con gas natural. Pero si se aumenta significativamente la producción de energía renovable, si se bajan los costos, si los costos de los electrolizadores siguen bajando, para el año 2032, en partes de Estados Unidos, podemos ver un costo de hidrógeno verde que llegue a casi cero. Entonces, la pregunta que algunos hacen es ¿por qué Estados Unidos no va a tener un monopolio sobre la producción de hidrógeno? Por una razón, no tenemos suficiente capacidad para la producción de energía renovable, para hacer las inversiones, la transmisión, la distribución, las inversiones en la red y toda la infraestructura de hidrógeno. Lo interesante aquí es, para los países en desarrollo, vamos a tomar ese ejemplo. Y un ejemplo de Chile, que tiene una capacidad de utilización de energía eólica de 70% al sur del país, más que cualquier otro lugar en el mundo. Para Chile lo interesante es juntarse con compañías que están invirtiéndose en Estados Unidos para bajar los costos, aprender las lecciones, aplicarlo en Chile y con eso ser competitivo y venderlo en Europa. Y eso es lo que están viendo países como Chile, como Brasil y otros que están haciendo estas inversiones ahora, incluyendo en el Medio Oriente. Voy a cerrar con esta observación. Lo que tenemos el día de hoy, quiero proponer, es que no es solamente una transición energética. Estamos manejando dos transiciones energéticas al mismo tiempo. Lo que vemos es que tenemos un mundo económico energético del día de hoy. Y la demanda es lo más difícil cambiar. Son cambios sociales, económicos, comerciales que se tienen que manejar. Y eso toma tiempo. Y si no abastecemos ese mercado, los precios suben. Si los precios suben, la complicación política se hace todavía más complicada y el apoyo para la transición energética toma más tiempo. Entonces, tenemos que abastecer ese mercado, tenemos que reducir esa demanda, tenemos que descarbonizar la oferta también. Pero al mismo tiempo, tenemos que construir la economía energética del futuro. Y algunas de las tecnologías las conocemos. Energía solar, energía eólica. Algunas son nuevas, como hidrógeno, como la captura de carbono. Pero aquí viene lo difícil. Se tienen que hacer al mismo tiempo. No es un asunto de hacer una y entonces mover para la segunda. Si no estás haciendo la segunda al mismo tiempo, la posibilidad de hacer esa transición no funciona. Y aquí yo diría que encontramos el desafío más grande que estamos encontrando con todas las compañías alrededor del mundo, entendiendo cómo balancear las emisiones para dirigirse a estas dos transiciones al mismo tiempo. Eso es algo que tenemos que confrontar. No va a ser fácil, va a ser dentro de un cambio geopolítico que es desafiante. Va a tener que hacer para llegar a net cero de emisiones para el 2050 a un paso que nunca se ha hecho en el mundo, pero la única manera que vamos a llegar es confrontar los desafíos directamente y tratar de encontrar los planes que se pueden utilizar, los planes B que se puedan alternar para poder cumplir con metas o movernos en direcciones que puedan ser más viables de lo que tenemos el día de hoy. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Carlos. Thank you very much. I'm going to switch to English so that at least we can all understand each other directly. And I want to thank you for the questions that I have received already, and a few of them are very, very interesting, so we're going to get into those. Before, I'd like to start with a very general question, but I think touches upon a little bit on both your presentations. And the general question is, how will the world look like? Right? So we used to live in a world, or we're living in a world that is geopolitically relatively simple. As Carlos has highlighted, oil played a huge role. So to a certain extent, we had providers of oil and buyers, and the relationships were pretty clear. Now it looks like we are going into a world that could go into either of two scenarios, right? One, perhaps more naive view, is to think that some of the technologies that we have developed already, solar, wind, are perhaps democratizing energy, right? So we might be going into a world that is has less dependencies and perhaps more independent blocks, right? And I think perhaps us Europeans think that we might be at some point almost able to be energy independent or more independent than before. Now, of course, if you start looking at where the value chains are, where the manufacturing, you know, for instance, solar panel is, the extreme dominance of China, as we sort of saw from some of your slides, kind of calls into question a little bit of that view, right? And now, of course, we've been doing more and more investments to reshore production of basic technologies like modules in the US and in Europe. But perhaps that's too little too late, because the economies of scale in China are so huge that will be really, really hard to beat. So perhaps, rather than having less dependencies, we're adding another layer of dependency, which is not just the one that relates to who has the raw materials, but it kind of adds a layer of dependencies that is more about who's actually going to be able to refine those raw materials and manufacture a lot of these basic technologies. So I guess it's a bit of a general question, but I think it's helpful for us to think a little bit about how will the world look like, right? Will it, at least from the energy perspective, is it going to be a more democratized and more independent or more complex, and perhaps some of the old players will still hold kind of the upper hand in determining a lot of geopolitical dynamics? I'm not sure who wants to start. Should we go with Thomas and then go back to Carlos? Shall we do that way, Thomas?
So the short answer is I don't know. And that's why we're also doing these scenarios, right? Because indeed there is a world where we get to blocks, protectionism. For Europe, this would mean less electricity growth, because we would not be able to import as much energy. So our way of living would need to change. We would probably need to have even a more aggressive mobility transition. You would have to have a even more aggressive transition of European industry and use of energy, right? Because in such a scenario, there's energy is not abundant anymore, and it's more scarce, hence energy efficiency, things like that become even more important, right? The other view of this, in my point of view, is that people realize that we are not in a dependent world, but in a mutually dependent world, right? So it's not, the dependence is both ways, right? Something that we thought we had with Russia, for example, but then we found out we didn't really, right? It was more a one-way dependency. I think also, you know, our trading partners, our trading partners may realize that there is a value actually in international trade, and there is a you know, prosperity, right? What is changing, or what I would say though, is still there will be winners and losers, right? Mm-hmm. So I would say a clear loser will be Russia, right? In any scenario, I don't see them sort of really gaining from either a politically, geopolitically tense scenario or a open scenario from an energy perspective, right? They're winners, probably the Global South, right? As I mentioned in my remarks, yeah. So, no crystal ball. I think that's why scenarios make sense, to make sure, understand what could be the range of outcomes and then prepare.
Thank you, Thomas. Carlos?
Thomas, I agree with you that we don't have the answers and we don't have crystal balls, that scenarios make sense. At one point in many discussions on energy transition, it was popular to assume the transition. We're in 2050, we have globalized renewable energy, we're much more dependent on the wind, the sun, energies that are immediately available, hydro, less dependent on international trade to be able to supply our energy markets. We're all safer and more secure, less international tension. The real issue here is frankly in the process of transition and the difficulty and pain that is caused. And I think number one is that the world hasn't responded to developing countries and their concerns. There, the number one issue has been energy access, eradication of energy poverty. And the scale of the problem we are only beginning to confront. Take an example of Indonesia. The international community came together with a $20 billion program to help reduce Indonesia's dependence on coal. But the cost of building the grid, the transmission lines, and the infrastructure that's necessary to put that in place is about $400 billion. And how does Indonesia be able to finance that? You know from your own situation in Europe, the tensions that exist that in principally coal-producing states and the economic pain that that causes in transition. And just to give a different perspective, I would say that the two countries that I've been in that are most excited about the energy transition are Saudi Arabia and the Emirates. From both of their perspectives, they believe that they have the lowest carbon content oil, the lowest prices of oil, and the last barrel of oil you're ever gonna buy is from them. And they also have the lowest cost in solar energy, that they're going to be able to use that to produce green hydrogen, and that they're going to be a major competitor in the energy transition world. So it turns on its head, I think, certain assumptions that we have, and it highlights this process of change that has to happen in the transition and the kind of economic, political, and commercial challenges we're going to have to face.
So if I, Carlos, if I can piggyback on that, and sort of going back to the 2030 objectives we have for green hydrogen in Europe, now the Repower EU has this general idea that we're gonna import about half of the expected demand, and we're gonna have domestic production for about half. I've been looking into a little bit of the projects that have been developing in Saudi. And not just the scale of the project is gigantic, and the land use is incredible. But of course, the cost levels are way different for a very simple reason. There's way more sun over there, right? So Are we kind of fooling ourselves that we're going to be able to produce so much green hydrogen at a competitive level domestically? Will we end up just becoming dependent on Chile, on Saudi? I think I was talking with the CEO of Aqua Power, and he was estimating that in order to produce 10 million tons by 2030, we need to cover about the size of Belgium in solar panels, right? So just the amount of land usage is incredible. Are we going to be able to achieve that anyway, or is it more kind of a nice plan that we put on paper just to make us feel
That's why we better. Will use offshore wind in Europe, because we cannot afford to plant Belgium with solar panels to produce 10 million tons. And, you know, according to our assumptions, the demand in Europe by 2050 is 60 million tons, right? So, yes, maybe for Spain that's the right solution to use solar, but not for all of Europe. Hence, the offshore development in the North Sea is very important. And that's also where we see a lot of activity at the moment. And probably, I would say, you know, a lot of mature projects like North H2, et cetera. So still it's like the entire energy transition is a challenge. But I think in terms of land use, I would not underestimate the you know, ability for innovation and project ideas. So if I get it right and see sort of the interest into these funding instruments from the European Hydrogen Bank and H2 Global, there are a lot of projects knocking on their doors at the moment. So there's enough ideas around. Let's see.
If I can go back to the offshore, and we actually had a question on offshore, the numbers of offshore are not great, though, right? I mean, just the levelized cost of electricity coming offshore is still quite high, especially compared to solar. So don't we run the risk to produce hydrogen at a much higher cost than other sources and or other parts of the world? And shouldn't be worried about industrialization or reindustrialization of other parts potentially becoming more energy competitive?
Well, according to our, you know, when we look at North Sea hydrogen projects, we first of all see production costs that are maybe not now, but sort of in not too far future, in the next 10 years, becoming more realistic. When we then talk to the customers, the industrial customers in Northern Germany, for example, or in Holland, and ask them about their alternative to this type of hydrogen, in some of the sectors, you actually get to a willingness to pay that should be in that order of magnitude, right? So I don't see it as negative. Now, if cheap imported hydrogen is coming into Europe and sort of if it comes in the form of methanol or ammonia and sort of, you know, all the cost of then cracking it and then, you know, reconverting it with all the efficiency losses, etc., and we get even in these use cases where we actually need to use hydrogen to better cost curve, that is then, yeah, you know,
even better.
There will be, I'm sure, there will be projects that will also can be supplied by European green hydrogen, and as I think also mentioned in my remarks, what is a very big issue for imported hydrogen is the cost of capital, which can be as much as 50% of the cost, the landed cost of the hydrogen here in Europe, right? And if we don't fix that, then the European industry will have to live with increasing or high energy costs, and that or energy costs that are not that are higher than they necessarily can be. Yeah.
Excellent. Carlos, I think from the US perspective, how do you see the green hydrogen development there and potentially be able to be cost competitive? Or do you think the US will end up importing a lot as well?
I think both. One of the things I tried to highlight with the examples of the IRA is that when you put together the subsidies on renewable energy, on hydrogen directly, it can bring the cost of hydrogen down significantly. It can be very competitive. Companies are investing in it on that basis. And the challenge is going to be how to be able to scale it and to do it without subsidies. But the other part of it is going to be how to be able to get access to the renewable energy that's necessary to be able to do that at scale. There are other factors where costs are increasing. The cost of steel is increasing. The cost of inputs are increasing. This is happening in Europe as well. And in many cases, the developers that have power purchase agreements, for example, are not able to meet those commitments because of the increased costs that they're facing. We also have to recognize that depending on the way that hydrogen projects are developed, there's only one that I'm familiar that uses, that produces hydrogen, converts it to methane, allows the use of existing shipping and storage facilities and pipelines. But for all other projects, you would have to put in place completely new infrastructure for shipping, storage, and pipelines as well. That's going to be extraordinarily expensive, but it's going to take time. I think Thomas highlighted that in one of his slides on the infrastructure cost. So yes, cost reductions, but major challenges ahead that we're going to face in being able to scale this up to the levels that we would all hope to see.
Thank you. Another question I wanted to ask is actually related to your final slide and specifically your last point, which is more on the macroeconomic conditions and the rising interest rates. Because if there's something that is extremely clear from your both presentations is that the scale of the investment is huge, and that means that we need private investment, right, to be able to reach that level. Otherwise, we just won't be able to do it just leveraging out of public budgets. Now, of course, between these costs that Carlos was talking about rising, cost of capital is going up. In the developed world, we know in the sort of developing world, it's usually two times as much or three times as much, and that's creating an additional issue, mostly because power utilities cannot leverage, or they used to the way they used to do, so they cannot push the electrification as they used to do, at least not at the same rate. We kind of saw that oil and gas are making more money, but they also have to invest more in exploration because that's what we've been seeing to try to meet demand until 2050. So I guess the general conditions are not becoming particularly more attractive for private investors. So what are we gonna do? can we create better incentives, different incentives to still make private investment attractive? Shall we rethink the role of the market and perhaps move the relationship between the investment of public investment with private? Can we explore different ways to finance the transition? What's your potential ideas to overcome some of these issues?
Okay, so I would start with saying funding the energy transition through public money will never work alone, right? So without private investments, this is not going to happen. The fiscal burden would be just too high, right? The second thing that I would say is, so what can we do? Yes, the industry can obviously still work on sort of improving efficiency, improving yields of the projects, etc., right? So also the industry needs to continue to do their homework, right? I think the regulators obviously need to think about sort of how to incorporate the higher interest rate environment into the formulas, be it on the debt side, but also on the equity side. I think as the sector needs to attract more equity, more innovative equity, maybe from, you know, through, you know, mezzanine structures, whatever, this will have a higher cost than what equity has a cost today. So regulators need to adapt to that new reality down the road. And thirdly, I would say the risk return profiles need to stay attractive for private investors. And there I do see a role for state institutions, state lenders to cap the risk so that privately money more easily is flowing into this by, I don't know, public lenders taking subordinate loan tranches or things like that, so that it's easier for investors to actually put their money on the table.
So,
and I've not commented on the market design question that you've sneaked in as well, but maybe we get to that later.
We'll do a second round. Carlos, are you also worried about interest rates, or should we be worried about interest rates?
I think all of the central banks that we have in all of our countries are telling us that we're going to have high interest rates for a long period of time. But in particular, for developing countries, they are especially worried about high interest rates because I think, as both Thomas and I suggested, it's not just a question of their national bank policies. It becomes a question of country risk, of utilities being able to capture revenue to be able to pay their debts, how that implies higher cost of capital. And that's going to be one of the biggest factors for inevitably the countries that are the biggest consumer, going to be the biggest consumers of energy throughout the world. So, I think that the interest rates are a huge problem, a huge challenge. I agree completely with Thomas on the importance of increasing the role of private investment. It's not a question of increasing it two or three times the levels of public investment. It's a challenge of increasing it tenfold or more. But here's an interesting sign. In the 4 months after the IRA was passed, what we began to see was that there was a significant movement of capital to funds, some into deployment, but particularly money moving into funds. There's a significant amount of capital that wants to move in OECD countries. Stress that again, in OECD countries. And what they're waiting for in the United States is to put in place the necessary changes to the tax code that makes it possible to be able to act on the IRA. And that's a complicated process. It's not a new process. It's been done for wind, it's been done for solar, but the process is still putting it in place for things like carbon capture and hydrogen on electric vehicles is still moving. It's going slower than people would like, and that's having a major impact on how quickly private capital is able to move.
So I think I have a few questions about regulations, and I actually wanted to get into some of that myself. So maybe, of course, IRA was this big shock that happened last year. A lot of capital is moving towards the United States, as sort of as Carlos has mentioned. If we have to pick one good thing that IRA has and we can learn from, and maybe we can try to pick one good thing of the European regulations, hopefully, as well, what would be the two things that you think have been good ideas that are helping move the transition along from the regulation standpoint?
Should Carlos answer this one first as IRA?
Carlos, you want to go first?
Well, I can jump in on the IRA. And I think one of the things that it's provided is flexibility. It indicates technologies. It indicates what the subsidy levels are. It leaves it to individual companies to make the choices of where to take the risks, where to place their investment bets. And that flexibility has been welcomed by many investors. And I'll put that in contrast to something that a major European company says, that right now under European regulations, the targets are set, the technologies are set, and the timeline is set. my ability to be an entrepreneur is compromised. And I think that there's going to continue to be a debate and tension between the U.S. and the European governments over this. It's going to be a continuing to, tension over the carbon price. But I think that probably the thing that stands out most about the IRA is that the way that the subsidies are structured, it's intended to give entrepreneurial, allow for entrepreneurial creativity and innovation. And that could be a significant plus over time.
So I agree. I would say the marketing of the IRA is also far better than the marketing of what the European Union is putting out. Because, I mean, first of all, there is the message, okay, this is the price level that you can get to. How you can get to this, and I think Carlos was alluding to this, is now only being worked out, right? So as the details, the tax code is actually not there yet. The European approach is different, right? We write a 1,000-page book, and then nobody understands the thing, and you need to buy us and other consultants to understand it or try to understand it, etc., right? Which is also ridiculous, right? And not really efficient. To your point, what is smart regulation? I really like this H2 Global approach by putting out auctions where producers can bid for contracts, where then the government is bridging, and likewise the producers bid for sort of, this is the price I'm willing to sell you the hydrogen for, and the demand sector is bidding for, this is the price that I'm willing to buy it from you, and then the government for the time period where this is not matching is picking up the bill, as you know, today production prices are higher than what industrial customers are able to afford. So as long as this is only a bridging instrument and not a permanent instrument, I think it's a smart thing to do. But I think I should say, with any subsidy, there's a big question mark whether these are actually temporary or whether we are they are actually long-term instruments. Mm-hmm. But that really, in order to kickstart the industry, is I think the right move.
And sort of following up, I think the role of technological neutrality tends to be positively seen, no? In regulations. We tend to like regulations that are technologically neutral, coming from the industry specifically. Is there a risk with technology neutrality as well? So, for instance, I was looking at some data here in Spain, and in terms of pipeline to 2030, solar, we already, we already reached the goal, but wind, we're lagging behind, right? So in the context of a transition where we need a little bit of a mix of technologies, perhaps can we run a risk of creating bubbles in one area and underfinancing in another? So is there a good sort of balancing of how much we can sort of channel money in different technologies, or should we just let the market choose?
The simple answer is let the market choose. I think the market needs to understand what is the grid connection capacity of all the solar that they're building. Is it actually able to produce, mm-hmm. right? That I'm not always sure whether people sort of actually have that knowledge, or think they're building a park, but then they see, well, the grid connection is only available in 5 years, and then we actually may not build as much solar. Again, I'm not too familiar with the Spanish situation, but sort of in other European countries, I would say that. But you're right. I mean, if that transparency is not there, and we're unrealistic and not synchronizing the grid development with the development where the generation is, so that the 10-year network development plans that conceptualize how the energy system should look like, and then the actual investment is not in sync, that this is a problem. Yeah. But I wouldn't say the solution is necessarily quotas on a very mm-hmm. sort of local level, but sort of more periodic reassessment. Are we getting there? Do we need to maybe, change more on a macro level, I would say.
Yeah.
Massimo, can I just add one thing here? Because I think there are two things in terms of regulation that have to be addressed, that without them, we're not going to succeed. Number one is permitting for infrastructure. And in the United States, for example, the requests for permits for renewable energy deployment is equal to the total amount of renewable energy that's actually deployed in the United States. The backlog is absolutely enormous, and the full impact of the IRA hasn't been felt yet. And if we can't actually find a way to accelerate the permitting process, then all of this is going to be theoretical. Second is the changes that are being put in place in part by the Securities and Exchange Commission and also by the Environmental Protection Agency on disclosure and emissions disclosure. And I think one of the things that's going to have to happen is having a greater convergence in the United States, but frankly across the world, of actual reported emissions. Not just reported emissions, but measured emissions. And right now, probably about 90 to 95% of emissions are actually calculated based on the standards of a machine, what fuel you put into it, and what the emissions are that come out of it. But we need to find a way to get to a place where we're tracking real emissions, there's transparency on who the emitters are, and that's going to create a different kind of regulatory capability. It's also going to have a huge impact on financing and where it goes. There are projects that are moving in that direction. On methane, for example, the Environmental Defense Fund has put huge resources that are coming online into satellites and aerial overflights. But it's that kind of investment in regulation and transparency on emissions that's going to be necessary to keep us all on track on where we need to go.
And how do we overcome the permitting issue, especially in a context where, more often than not, I'm not super familiar with the U.S. in this specific element, but at least here in Europe, we're getting a lot of resistance, NIMBY, resistance from local communities. So in many ways, making the permitting quicker or more agile is politically risky, right? So I think that's part of the reason why we're still struggling with this, and by all means, this is a huge issue and a huge roadblock to sort of rolling out more projects. What would be some good solutions that we can try out to try to speed up these processes?
I would say three things come to mind. First of all, we need to change the structure of the law. We would need to fight bureaucracy, and we need to share part of the margin with the local communities. So by changing the law, I mean, in many countries, there's just too many levels of, you know, where people can appeal, right? And so that is, I think, one trigger. The other one is the different rights of law are on the same level. In Germany, for example, we're now putting the energy or law in a way above other areas of law, like nature conservation, etc., so that there is also clearer that this is a priority, right? And the last thing that I think has proven a good accelerator is that involving the local communities, not only the landowners that profit from the projects, but also really the communities to accelerate the permitting. And there are many more things that one could do, but these are the three things that I would in my mind, are quite important.
Carlos, do you want to add to that?
Or? I would agree with Thomas, and I would say that they still have been difficult to put in place. In the United States, we've had many attempts at changes in legislation, and it often gets into battles between left and right, because the way legislation is currently structured is that you would change all legislation. So environmental groups that would also see the construction of more natural gas pipelines have been opposed, and it's made it very difficult to be able to move forward. This issue of different levels of government, just to underscore here what Thomas said, is huge, because there are national level of regulations, there are individual states, there are local and municipal regulations, and getting any kind of harmony and some understanding of precedents among them has also become hugely complicated. And right now, the question of permitting is perhaps the biggest roadblock that could cause failure in the energy transition than anything else. It simply will just prevent the infrastructure from being put in place and on the ground. And if we can't deal with that, then we're going to get stalled, and we don't have very good solutions.
Very, very clear. Related to regulations, and I want to ask a follow-up question after this one. But I have an interesting question on the development of the developing world, right? So, and it's an ethical question to a certain extent, but it's a question that's being touted more and more often. We know very clearly now that without decarbonizing, large chunks of the developing world, we're not going to be able to reach net zero targets. And I guess the question for us as Westerners who did enjoy the ability to pollute and without much limit and grow kind of calls a bit into question our ethical stance, right? So and the person that asked the question here is it reasonable to expect others to decarbonize much faster than we did from a standpoint of being poorer, right? So of course, the developing countries, China, India, have longer term sort of objectives. But at the same time, how can we be credible in our plea and in our collaboration efforts, given that, of course, right, per capita we did pollute much more historically than others? So what kind of sort of global partnerships can we set up, or institutions we can set up, to try to reach this goal? I think, Carlos, you were making an example of Indonesia, if I'm not mistaken, earlier on. I think it was a very clear example, right? Even when we devote and dedicate money, it's not enough, right? We don't account for all the different items that are actually needed. So, and connected to that, Carlos, I think you were very clear. We don't have institutions, global institutions, that can really help coordinate these kind of efforts now, right? So should we create some? Can we create market mechanisms? Should we think about regulation? What would be a good way to try to make sure this is not just efficient but also fair?
So I would make two comments. The first, I disagree that the developing world doesn't have an interest in itself to decarbonize, right? So if you think about China, their environmental problem is way bigger than we have here, right? I mean, I ran into a Chinese person in Australia when I was down there, and I was talking to him and, asking him, because it was, a place in Australia where total darkness and you could see really the stars and the sky and the galaxies, and he says, well, I'm traveling here thousands of miles because once in my life I want to see this, I want to see the stars. He never saw stars in China because you actually can't see them. It's just too polluted down there, or up there, or there. So don't underestimate the willingness and the understanding in the developing world that they need to change themselves as well. to your other part of the question, yeah, there is ideas around like having not only a World Development Bank, but also a World Energy Transition Bank. These ideas, I think, are out there for quite a while. And as I mentioned before, I think we need some kind of public international lenders, institutions that actually, you know, provide financing, especially for these developing or for developing countries that that can't afford it. I think China can afford it, others can afford it, but not all. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I would just add that one of the critical things that's going to be a factor is addressing in a comprehensive way debt in developing countries. Increasingly what's happened, particularly with increased interest rates, is that more and more developing country budgets are focused on repaying debt, less that's going into energy, infrastructure, healthcare, education. And unless that broader macro issue is dealt with, it becomes very complicated. There are World Bank mechanisms to be able to do that, getting Chinese cooperation as the largest bilateral creditor to developing countries, certainly in Africa, is another part that has been complicated to be able to move forward. On oil and gas, one of the issues is demand of developing countries has been, how do they produce their oil and gas to be able to compete with other countries that continue to produce oil and gas at a point in time that the world is going to continue to use it? And there, one of the issues is going to be, is the stance of the international community to prevent international oil companies and gas companies from investing in the developing world, or can they invest in those countries and bring their technology if by doing so, they allow those companies to compete as a provider with lower emissions and being able to provide that. That's been a big issue in the provision of gas, and particularly from Europe, as Europe was seeking contracts throughout Africa at a point in time it entered into a crisis with Russia. In the power sector, one of the issues that has been tried in many parts of the world and has worked successfully in many countries is when you have auctions and the companies that are bidding in the auctions are using their balance sheet to finance their debt, and the companies are then bidding at the price of which they can provide the electricity, that becomes a much more interesting alternative than a government saying that it wants to build a specific facility and asking for companies to then bid on that, because then the developing country is carrying the debt, its risk, its cost of capital is much higher. And if one can look at innovative different ways of bringing known administrative technologies like the administration of auctions to different parts of the world, in Latin America, we've seen already how that radically lowered the cost of electricity in countries like Colombia and Brazil. It did in Mexico until Mexico actually ended the auctions for other types of political reasons. So those are the kinds of things that I think are pragmatic mechanisms that can be done now without a serious amount of reconstruction of institutions.
Thank you, Carlos, for example. Very interesting. Sort of related to this, what do you think of mechanisms such as CBAM? So the idea of having carbon border adjustment mechanisms. It's a huge debate, of course. The idea is that it's going to create some incentives to decarbonize to the trading partners, to places like Europe. Do you think we'll help? Is it a good idea? Are we still in time to rethink some of that? Is it just a different way to spell the word protectionism, perhaps, right? So what's your take?
Well, it's definitely a form of protectionism in a world that doesn't apply CO2 prices throughout the world, right? If all the economies would actually have CO2 prices, then we would be already better off. Now, actually, a lot of countries are introducing CO2 prices. Also, there, Europe is not the only place, right? So, it's a tough question because nobody knows whether the CBAM idea really will work, right? I think the basic idea for the transition period sort of get to a CO2 price or, you know, fix that not every country, every producer is exposed to a CO2 price is conceptually the right idea. I think the way the European Union goes about it is, again, quite complex and hence maybe, yeah, not the right idea. The implications or ramifications for CBAM, I think is, if it's working, hopefully then sort of it gives the European industry enough time to restructure and decarbonize and then sort of stay competitive. But I don't have a firm view on sort of whether CBAM will work the way it's intended.
Carlos?
I would just add that the issue of carbon pricing between the United States and Europe is going to be an ongoing issue. It's interesting, in the United States, the call for carbon pricing was generally on the environmental left. The left spectrum of American politics has now abandoned carbon pricing because they feel that it's against a just transition and will increase prices for disadvantaged communities. So ironically now you have companies like ExxonMobil calling for a carbon price and the US left against a carbon price. I don't see it changing. To win an election, a presidential in the United States, you have to carry certain states, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Michigan, probably Minnesota. All of those states have heavy industry, automotive, steel, gas, and they've come out adamantly against some form of carbon pricing. So ironically, right now, to become president of the United States, you can't support a carbon price, and I don't see it happening in the near term. So we're going to have to figure out some other mechanisms, probably based on transparency of reporting on carbon emissions and how that gets compensated. And I can imagine that those are going to be very interesting, tedious, and extended conversations.
Thanks, Carlos. I have one question about Spain, because we've been talking about global, we've been talking about the EU, but of course there is some interest from the room about the role of Spain within the EU, but also more globally in general, within the context of the energy transition. So what kind of role can Spain, the Spanish economy, the Spanish society play in this global process?
Well, first of all, Spain is endowed by a lot of renewable energy, especially solar energy, but also wind, which makes it one of the producers for low carbon hydrogen. I think if Spain would be even better connected to the European copper plate, Europe would benefit a lot, also Spain, I think. I think there is a role for Spain also as a hub for gas trading, as it's historically been, being a very large LNG importer, and then maybe also creating somewhat of a hydrogen import hub with North Africa, etc., going forward. So,
So there's some optimism to build up a little bit of the Spanish pride in the room, right? We're not.
Yeah, I mean, there's not too many large industrial economies that have managed to get to that level of renewables use like Spain, right? So I think it's an example that many countries in the world look to very closely, and I'm sure you're receiving visitors from all over the world frequently to understand the Spanish situation, how you've done this. So, and I think I don't see a reason why this is stopping. Again, being even more interconnected, also with not only the power side, the hydrogen side, etc., obviously always helps to create a little bit of a hub here in Southern Europe.
Yeah, no. At the end of the day, these matters are quite complicated. But at the end of the day, of course, having better solar irradiation is very important. Mm. Having land availability is very important, and I think Spain has both, right? So, especially in the context of Europe, should be one of the best places to keep sort of making the transition moving. Carlos, do you have another suggestion for the role of Spain?
I think the points that have been put on the table are absolutely critical, and I think are really at the heart of the equation. I think it's worth taking a moment to maybe drill down on the issue of hydrogen. One of the things that's being found around the world is that to make hydrogen commercially viable, you in the end ideally have to connect it with multiple forms of abatement, with steel, with petrochemicals, with glass, with paper. And I think one of the interesting things for Spain will be to explore whether it can be an innovator, given its capacity in low-cost renewable energy, to somehow connect that as well with off-takers, because this is one of the pieces that the world needs to figure out how to advance, how to connect the hydrogen potential with the off-takers that will demand that hydrogen. Because unless we can make that link in a commercially competitive way, it'll be difficult to succeed. And maybe Spain can provide some examples on how that can be implemented that could be take a leadership role in many different parts of the world.
I can only underscore this. So creating industrial clusters that actually ideally have at some point negative carbon emissions because they are producing synthetic fuels and material, etc., sort of taking carbon either out of the air or out of other carbon sources is, I think, very important. And I would also expect more and more industry clusters actually to work like that, right? So that we see more of more of a co-location of industries like cement and steel and the production of renewables.
So we're close to the end, and I like one question, which I think was the best question to try to close this, because we've been talking about a lot of problems, and so I think the question is really more about trying to be a bit optimistic. So there's one thing to be optimistic about, which is the cocktail, which I remind everybody that we're gonna have cocktail that we can sort of continue the conversation together in about 5 minutes. But jokes aside, of course we're looking to 2050. A lot of complications, technological challenges, regulation is a problem. Geopolitical tensions are becoming more and more complex. If we want to try to close on a more optimistic sort of note, what are the things that you would like to sort of underscore that we're doing well, that is happening, and hopefully can give us some good expectations about being able to achieve and succeed in this incredible challenge that lies in front of us?
So if I may, it seems I'm starting here. So I would say two things. One, in my observation, all of the big corporations in Europe and more also in the US and more also in Asia are working on decarbonization plans as we speak. I don't know of any listed large corporation that would say, hey, we have a following strategy, we have the others work it out, and then in 5-10 years when the dust has settled, we'll start to think about this. I think all corporations, and going forward even also the more family-owned, the smaller corporations, I think, you know, need to do the same. They are working on really thinking about how can we transform our business model with all the challenges, et cetera. So that makes me optimistic that there's more that is happening, that sort of is being seen by the public, I would say. And the second thing that I would say, maybe, which is it a black swan or a pink swan or so, that the advancements in negative emissions technology may come sooner than we think. Mm-hmm. These are the two points that I would say.
And if I can follow up, why do you think that's the case? Do you just see trends happening? Do you?
There is some now industrial-sized technology being built, and you know of the direct air capture projects, but there's also other projects that have a different technology. It's now being built in Texas. I think, like with any technological development, we always think it's a linear line, right? Because for decades, nothing is happening, right? And that we think, okay, it's going to continue like this, but then sort of we have this exponential development. And what I've been hearing is that, you know, at least I thought this would take longer. So let's see.
Excellent. Carlos?
Let me say four things, some of which will echo what Thomas said. But the first is that decarbonization and reducing emissions has become a license to operate for industry. Energy, but generally, there's a recognition that if you're going to be able to continue to operate from a social perspective and sustain social scrutiny, but secondly, to raise capital and finance, and increasingly, the ability to obtain capital is going to depend on your ability to show a declining path of emissions and the actions that you're taking to be able to do that. And those two things together are becoming a new license to operate that's linked to decarbonization, which is absolutely critical. On innovation, the thing that is quite striking to me is that there is increasingly cooperation among private companies, universities, national laboratories, and it's national and it's across countries, in ways that haven't been seen before. And I hope they continue to come up and accelerating those innovations. I don't know what pace it's going to be. You know, we all love to see fusion coming out around the corner, but that process of innovation is one that has huge potential because it has the collaboration of the critical partners. The third thing I would say is the technology that's emerging to monitor emissions. This is absolutely critical because the more that becomes a global capacity and capability combined with the necessity to report, then nobody can hide. This is something where problems are going to be highlighted. We're going to be able to see it, and that's going to apply social pressure, financial pressure to act. And the final thing I would say is youth, young people who think very differently about their social commitment, their commitment to act, the way that they are willing to change their behavior, change their own personal consumption of fossil fuels. That's going to be a critical part of this equation, and they're setting an example that the rest of us need to open our eyes to and follow.
Thank you, Carlos. I'll share my degree of optimism, hopefully. What I think is positive is that it's not just the EU. I think we've done a lot of heavy lifting and in the last few decades, and I felt like perhaps other parts of the world were not necessarily pushing or putting enough efforts in it. But I think it's pretty clear with the IRA, it's pretty clear what's going on with Saudi 2030, what's going on in China. I think everybody's taking this huge challenge very, very seriously. And to a certain extent, we're competing with each other, which I think is good, right? We tend to like competition. We tend to think competition is the right way to improve, to innovate, to become more efficient. And I think ultimately the fact that the IRA came, made us Europeans angry a little bit on one hand, but also pushed us to improve on our rules and our governance and on our regulation. I think that's critical and absolutely very important. A few takeaways from today. I think we saw the slides, we saw the data. I think things are happening. We're moving in the right direction, not fast enough, right? We've been talking about a few of the challenges. Some of these are regulatory. Some of these are technological, like this. Some of these are economic fundamentals, right? But there are ways to overcome all these challenges with a little ingenuity and putting our minds to it. Another thing I want to take away from today is that we have to be really, really, perhaps scared about the U.S. elections and sort of that are coming up. And sort of Carlos gave us that kind of insight on how that's going to be a critical moment in the next 12 months to potentially change the dynamics of the world and the global trends. It is a little scary that whether we like it or not, the U.S. has been source of stability for many, many years, and looking at what's happening in Congress these days make, I think, all of us a little scared, right? Because we can always have discussions about whether we should go in one direction or another. What's really, really scary is falling into, I guess those are signs that we should probably go to the cocktail, no? Maybe the scariest thing is that we are standing still, right? We cannot even decide where to go, and I think that's a little bit of a what at least makes me a little scared. But again, I should have closed on an optimistic note, so sorry, right? If I didn't, join me in a round of applause and sort of thanking Thomas, thanking Carlos for the really nice insights and conversations. And I think we can continue the conversations informally at the cocktail. Carlos, I'm sorry you cannot join us for the cocktail, but hopefully it's going to be for the next time. Get better. Yeah.